What up, meatheads? This is Travis, American Butcher, and this is the Meat Block Podcast, the weekly podcast by butchers for everyone. And since this week I am on vacation, I am going to do a Q&A. I posted a photo of some dry aged meat on a few days ago on Instagram, then asked people to submit their questions, and this is what I got. So if you don't like it, then please submit more questions. Right now, I'm enjoying quality time with my family in beautiful Santa Barbara, California. I'm also surprised that the last 2 weeks I have made it through the intro without tripping over my tongue, saying the F word, and then having to start over. So without any further delay, here is the meat block.
Good cutting enhances the quality of good meat. In his way, the meat cutter is an artist. Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of meat, regardless of quality.
And here we go. First question is by... Oh, man. This is going to be the hardest part of this whole fucking thing, is reading all of your Instagram names, because I am severely dyslexic. So if I pronounce it wrong or anything like that, then... that's on you. So here we go. This is from at PYTan. What's the most ideal number of days for dry aging? Well, 21 days is when the proteins are completely denuded and stripped. Anytime after that, you're just going to be adding flavor and to the profile. It's already going to be at maximum tenderness. It may have the potential to even get a little bit tougher as it dries for longer, but it really shouldn't. I've only experienced that on the ball tip off the sirloin, that it ends up getting a little bit harder when it's super dry, but it's also different muscle structure than most things that you would dry age. Even though I have... done whole carcasses before. Right now, my company is just doing drop loins, which is the sirloin and the short loin or New York section with the tenderloin still attached. So it's just one giant piece off the hind quarter, and we're doing the ribeye section, and we're aging all these things bone in, which helps me walk right into the next question. Real Abe, former junior, from Instagram, what's the best dry ager at home? What's the best way to dry age at home? Also, that question was asked by another person, what's the best way to dry age at home? And just know that it's going to be difficult because you want to do it with the bone in, so the bone takes the brunt of the aging. So when you trim it off, that you're not losing lean. And if it's like a drop loin or something like that, you're going to want to do it. You know, if you're doing the tenderloin, you want the suet still on it. So the suet, same idea, that you don't end up barking up your tenderloin. And with these, you could, what you really need to do is find an old upright refrigerator, on Craigslist. You're going to want to take out all the shelving except for one. Put a tray of salt in there to help with your humidity, and then maybe put a small desk fan or computer fan in there to help with your air circulation. And the colder, the better. Really, it's something that a lot of people don't recommend to do at home. I believe it is something that could be achieved at home. If you're looking more into dry aging, I would, something that you could do in like a basement, I would just recommend like curing pieces of meat and things like that, where your temperature doesn't have to be a refrigeration. But for true dry aged steak, it has to be, the colder the better, with a ideal humidity between 80 and 85%. Now, once you dry age, one thing that people don't realize is that dry aged meat is technically safer than fresh beef. Because one thing that you take away out of it is the water. So available water is what allows certain organisms to grow. And when you eliminate some of that water, then it makes it a little bit safer, even though you are going to get that bark on the outside. Now, you may be hearing this and saying, well, I don't have a refrigerator and I don't have access to whole primals. And what I've seen and haven't done is I've seen people take cuts of meat, cover them in like rendered down suet, which turns into tallow, then age that whole piece, and then the tallow takes on the age and leaves the steak, you know, fresh on the inside. But I can't 100% back this because it's something I haven't done, and I certainly don't want to recommend something that is unsafe. Now, another thing you could do, like at my shop, that you could buy a whole primal, put it on hold, and then age it for you. And when it's ready, we'll cut it into retail packs or give it to you so you could process it at home or whatever, where essentially we are just charging you for the piece of meat plus a little VIG for the storage fee. Maybe a lot of maybe some other cut and wraps in your area will do this, so you don't have to, you know, get this whole setup. You also got to think about what's the advantage of rigging something up at home to do this. Certainly, if you get it working and you're able to get bone-in cuts and things like that, and control it, and you know you're going to save money, and which is always good. But if you end up aging boneless like exports, then the trim and the bark you're going to have to change off or trim off may not make it worth it. Where I'd recommend trying to find it somewhere where I know it's difficult to find dry aged beef too. Likely places you're going to find it would be at like a co-op grocery store, perhaps a Together Foods or a farmer's market. And just know when you're cooking dry aged meat that it's going to cook a little bit faster because it has less moisture. Which brings me to my next question at Ja 31 asks, why do people like dry aged meat? Well, one of the reasons I think people enjoy the taste of dry aged meat is because you're tasting more of the meat protein itself with the water loss and bringing that available water. You're tasting more pure meat instead of water. Also, with the dry age process, it's denuding, it's stripping, it's making it tender, it's making it more palatable, where you could almost just sometimes cut it with the back of a spoon. Your cooler situation is going to act like a cheese chamber almost, where you're going to be, you know, it's going to absorb the flavor of your cooler. So the cleaner your cooler and the better airflow you got, the better palate it's going to be versus if you have a cooler with that you're constantly putting hot products in, where it may get more of a sour taste. Now, I worked at a place that we did slaughter, and we would hang our carcasses for 3 weeks on the rail before cutting them. And our dry age cooler was also our hot box. So it introduced a bunch of humidity and took it from that nice bark, blackish with little spots of white, you know, that you want to see on the outside, to like a green fuzz. And that's something you certainly don't want. And this beef, when it wasn't dry aged, when it was fresh, was almost unpalatable. And the dry aging process brought out a richer flavor, a more earthy flavor. And our minimum there was 3 weeks. When I worked retail, we would do 6 weeks. One time we found a sirloin that was sitting in the back of the dry age rack that was labeled, and someone forgot about it. And it was there for like almost, you know, 9 months, and we boned it out. It was like boning out a rock. And the people I was working with, we all took a little piece of the sirloin, a little piece of the ball tip, a little piece of the culotte, grilled it up and ate it. And it was almost too rich and too intense for us, where dry aging is almost like wine, where, you know, I think half the people like it because of the price point, and the other half actually know what they're tasting and the flavors and what they should be expecting. So when you're eating dry aged meat and you want to sound profound or want to sound like you know what you're talking about, you know, say phrases like, wow, this really brings out the earthiness in the forage of what this animal was eating. It's like I could taste the keratin in the grass. It's like I'm walking side by side the animal in the pasture, feeling the breeze along my back as I'm chewing my cud. When in reality, a lot of the dry aged beef that you're going to get at like a restaurant or does in-house dry age is going to be using, you know, subprimals from corn-fed IBP beef that they just dry there on site, which there's nothing wrong with that by any means. It's just something that when you want to play that card that you know what you're talking about, make sure when you close your eyes and you envision what the animal is eating, that maybe you're going to close your eyes and envision a feedlot. I got a bunch of people asking me about dry aged beef, but I certainly feel like I talked about that enough. And we did record a episode about it. And I would encourage you to go back through our library and listen to that episode and all of our episodes. A good way to soak up this information is by putting in earbuds or a sleep type of headphone and then just play this on repeat and just while you sleep, you know, and absorb osmosisly. And yeah, I don't think that's a word. And then that gets my numbers up. And then you feel good that you feel like you learned something. At Chris Quality Cuts asks, what's the difference or what's the distance between Oroco, Victoria, Australia and where you are? And I would say the distance is pretty fucking far. Which brings me to my next question at Against Her Grain, who's been on the show before. So just know that. Check that out. I believe we recorded it around Thanksgiving. So just go back in the index and check out Samantha's old episode. And she asks, y'all ever think about doing events? And that's a great question. I would love to do events. I would love to travel and teach and do something that's less hard on my body than, you know, my current job. Also, I'm also constantly looking for new adventures and new challenges and giving talks and demos or just meeting people. I don't know if that's sustainable in the sense of supporting my current, debt to income ratio. And right now my weekends are spent with my family and hopefully, they'll be more busy coming up and I'll be making frequent trips to Sacramento. Wish me luck. And I've thought about it before what I would do in an event like setting. That I would love to travel someplace and go to a shop and do a Q&A, maybe do a demo, but don't really want to check a bag. And that usually means bringing knives and things like that. Or I guess I could use house knives. But, you know, just talk or meet at like a local bar. I know there's a great place. There's some great bars that do in-house charcuterie, I know, in many cities. And if I'd be honored to go there, but again, the meat block's funds right now are at zero, so it would really have to be local to the state of Washington, and not because I'm crass or petty, but I would need at least to have my ticket and hotel or something paid if it was out, if I require traveling. So if you're out there listening and you would think that, you know, that would be beneficial to do an event at your shop and have me or Ryan or David, I don't think it'd be feasible to get all of us there. Or if you're an educator and you're teaching a butcher program or you're teaching something, let me know. I started this podcast to share the knowledge and share my experience in this industry. And I would really love to do that in a more personal level and reach out to the listeners. But also I know what our analytics say. So if I were to go to some places, I think it would just be me and one other person there. So it'd really have to rely on like a touring band type thing where you have, you know, the local band also booked on the bill to get people to show up to see the band that's on tour. And then, I would be the touring band at that point. Before the WBC and this big thing, there are events like Koshan and Lam Jam. But I was thinking, like, what would be a good event for the industry? That's also completely self-satisfying or self-serving and makes me look awesome. So one day I was daydreaming, what would it be? What would it be? And there's the Ferndale Event Center here, and that's the big place where we have the Bellingham Comic Con, even though it's not in the city of Bellingham, or we have the Ferndale Gun Show and all these other places. It's a big event center. And I actually did some culinary work out there about 2 years ago as a side job. It was terrible. And I was thinking, what would be an event I would like to do if I were to host an event? And I was thinking to myself, like, I really like low maintenance. So it's like, I'd get the Ferndale Event Center or like the conference room of like the Holiday Inn or Sheraton or something like that and book it for like 2 years in the future and then just promote online that it would be like the Butcher's Meet and Greet, and it'd be Meet M-E-A-T, you know, because that's clever. And so what this event would be just anyone's welcome, but it'd just be like all the social media butchers, as many people as we could get to go to it. And then that's the greeting, I guess. And then the meat would be, I would get a whole hog from my work cut in half because I could get it at a very, very good deal. And if you're at this event and you're a butcher, you're going to write down your name on, you know, a piece of paper. And then we're going to put it in a bowl. We're going to draw two names and you're going to just instantly throw down. One person gets a half a hog. The other person gets another half a hog. And you got an hour and a half access to different rubs and spices. And then we're going to have grills right there. And that's going to be the meat that feeds the event. And if you're someone who identifies yourself as a butcher or a cutter and you're at this event, you are definitely going to have to put your name in that hat. And what you win nothing at this point, because it's just an idea in my head that I said out loud for the first time right now. So if you're the type of person who likes to make shit happen, make that happen and somehow let me be involved. Next question comes from @RockyRed86, who Ryan interviewed, I think late last year. He asks, have you ever considered working for the USDA in any capacity or becoming a meat inspector yourself? And yes, to the point where I have applied at usajobs.net. And if you want to be a USDA inspector, I'll just lay this out real quick before I give my two cents or my feelings about myself wanting to be it. You either come at it from a education background with a degree or education in food science, animal welfare, or you come at it from a practical standpoint where if you've worked in a USDA inspected plant for 2 years, then you could apply for the USDA. And working in the sense of like working daily with the USDA. I once worked with this guy, I'm not going to say his name, but he was our plant cleaner. And he was like, Travis, I was talking to Sarah, the inspector, and she was saying that if after 2 years of working here, I could become a USDA inspector or apply. And I told him, like, I was a dick and shattered his dreams. And I was like, well, what are you going to do? Clean the USDA offices? Because he was the plant cleaner. I thought it was funny. Now looking back at saying it, I was an asshole. But when you apply for the USDA, they're going to most likely put you into slaughter for at least 2 years, or unless you make yourself available for transfer to other positions, where each place you transfer is going to more or less be a bonus or upward mobility within the USDA. I have myself applied for the USDA several years ago. There was uncertainty in where I wanted to go career-wise and my work situation at the time. It's a very long process, and a way to ensure that you will be selected is putting that you are willing to move anywhere in the country. The USDA will move you anywhere in the country because there's some places in rural parts that need inspectors. Now, the dream job that I thought I would want to do would be a relief inspector. I know a great relief inspector who lives locally here in Washington, but he is responsible for relieving plants between Colorado and Hawaii and Alaska. So he wakes up on Monday and he is either driving to the airport or driving in his government car and then staying in hotel rooms and inspecting. And it seems like a great life for someone who is single. He is married, but his children are a little older. So maybe it works out good for him. It also seems like a great job that if you just wanted to do it for a few years to immerse yourself in the industry, and I view that, what he's doing, as a great education. Would I want to work for the USDA right now? I don't know. I really enjoy having some hands-on work and education. I hate being the bad guy, and I truly hate filing reports and paperwork. Especially, I've worked with USDA inspectors who would tell me how they would walk into plants and it's like the whole plant hated them because they are the enemy. And if you've ever talked to me outside of this podcast for any length of time, then you would know my political views and where I stand with the government. All right. Like I said, I was going to get a ton of names wrong. At Morgan Meredidua. At Morgan. Have you ever processed goat before? Yes. I have slaughtered, I don't even know how many goat, and cut most of the goat that I have killed. Yes. A lot of times, some places who want goat just want it, you know, halfway frozen, cut up on a bandsaw. For making more of like braising type dishes. Some cut and wrap facilities, you know, will just use a lamb / goat cut sheet, and then you just pretty much cut it the same. I personally don't enjoy goat meat or lamb meat that much. I know that's blasphemy for some people. David loves lamb and mutton. It's just a flavor profile that I think I'm not used to growing up where I did. I also don't like the smell of goats when they're alive. At Casey Hart asks, why are majority of retail cases boneless or bone out now? Any thoughts? I don't know. Maybe bones freak out large portion of American consumers. My first initial reaction, and I recorded it and went back and deleted it, was that it had to do with SRM, but the animals that are being sold in retail settings are far younger than would be affected by that. They're usually slaughtered around 14 and 15 months when SRM in spinal columns and the wings of the sacrum and all those other bones are developed at 30 months. Probably has to do with the fact that the suppliers could get a better margin for their bones, turning it into animal byproduct, grinding it up into bone meal for other applications, and the fact that the American consumer, besides wanting a bone-in ribeye, is mostly turned off to bone-in cuts, unless it's ribeye or ossobuco or beef shank, because ossobuco literally translates leg of veal, or as I like to call it, awesome buco. Here's a question from P A-L-O-M-O, Pit Barbecue. Are you on Instagram TV or YouTube? If not, should we expect a channel from you? I have one video posted on my Instagram TV, and every episode of the Meat Block can be found on our YouTube channel. Also, I have some videos, slaughter videos, on my YouTube channel. It's a medium that I don't really enjoy. IGTV is too new for me to know if it's good or not. So, yeah. I just don't enjoy posting stuff on YouTube. I enjoy watching stuff on YouTube. At Simon Butch asks, have you ever seen a grown man cry? Yes. I forget the particular circumstances, but I seem to recall some sadness that I've witnessed firsthand. Maybe when England got knocked out of the World Cup. Maybe there's some people crying then. I'm just messing with you, Simon, and look forward to hanging out with you in 2020. At Shigunyu, what is, in your opinion, the hardest part of cattle to market? Now, if you were to ask me what the hardest part about slaughter was, I would have a very quick answer for you. That would obviously be my... But the hardest part about getting cattle to market, I don't know if you mean like in the marketing sense or the transportation sense or the whole slaughtering process. I guess just finding a customer basis would probably be the hardest part. Once you have that, the rest of it is, if you're a small producer, it's going to be hard to find a small processing facility, USDA, that's not overwhelmed. I don't know. I need more insight, like what particular step is the hardest. The hardest is honestly raising and growing quality product, quality meat that people enjoy the flavor profile of and people want to buy. At Doug Shirley writes, why do my local briskets not look at all like Packer boxed briskets? Am I cutting them off the shoulder wrong? Usually, Packer style briskets are going to be four quarters, going to be ran through a bandsaw, and it's going to be peeled. And you just pretty much have to remove part of the foreshank and the brisket off. So it's very symmetrical. It's not going to have as much of the flap up top, and it's not going to have that part that wraps around the forearm. So when you cut them at your shop, unless you're doing it really wrong, it's going to be bigger when you do it at your shop. Which brings me to another brisket question. Oh, God, you guys hate me with your Instagram names. At CNIKOLAOU asks, what's the difference between brisket, navel, and navel? So in Australia, I believe, and this is going off of Jess Prowls, what she told me is that when you buy a brisket in Australia, it still has the navel attached to it. And here in America, the navel is removed, and we just end up with a brisket with the point, which is the fatty end, and the flat, which is the end that turns into the navel. What's the difference between them is I would view the navel as the poor man's brisket. It's a great meat, piece of meat, and if you know how to cook it right, you're going to get a good product out of it. A lot of times it is substituted for brisket for like pastrami applications. It's good. It's quality. I enjoy it. Some people make beef bacon out of it. I've in the past had a very difficult time selling this item to the general public, so I just recommend using it as you would for corned beef or pastrami. Or use it to fatten up your grind, because you can't fuck up a hamburger. At St. Jen Yu has another question. Russia has the world's largest Angus herd. Why? And I don't know. I know America has one of the largest herds of beef, and one of our major exports is beef and pork, and our position on exporting products allowed us, or continues to allow us, to have a seat at the table internationally. But I know countries like Russia and China are buying up vast land in South America to get their herds up to snuff, which will, in a few years, make it so it's harder for us to contribute to that market, which is going to do two things. It's going to make meat prices in America go down, but it's also going to be like inflation, where it's going to have a back end where it's going to cause a lot of people to possibly make less money. The company I work for, recently we had a meeting where we talked about the new trade tariffs going on effect with the pork export to China, and what this would, we were talking about the hypotheticals because we just don't know what the consequences would be. And what our fear is, because if you're selling a premium product of pork, you know, added value, local, all this stuff, that your competition is going to now be able to get pork at a cheaper price and be able to margin you out or get a bigger piece of the market. And I imagine soon that pork prices are going to drop in America, and we're probably going to see the McRib come back, because every time the American market is flooded with pork, that pork prices drop, and then the McRib comes back. So just be on the lookout for that. And my last question comes from at SilverKing50. This is the only question that I actually had to do a bunch of research on and to find the correct answer. I certainly didn't want to mess this one up. And his question is, who framed Roger Rabbit? And what you got to understand is that Judge Doom wanted to buy Toontown, but Marvin Acme wouldn't sell it. And according to Doom, he asked R.K. Morgan to blackmail Acme. As a result, Doom knew Morn had shown Roger evidence that Jessica Rabbit was having an affair with Mr. Acme, therefore giving Roger motive to kill him. And if you recall from that film, the images, cartoon style of Roger looking through the pictures over and over again of Jessica Rabbit and Mr. Acme playing patty cake. So Doom, using that opportunity to kill Acme, hoping everyone would think that Roger did it. Although the murder doesn't appear on screen, it is implied by the dialogue that Jessica Rabbit has with Judge Doom that he killed Marvin Acme. And there you go. Doom framed Roger Rabbit. Oh yeah, spoiler alerts. All right, meatheads, that's going to do it for this week's episode of the Meat Block Podcast. I hope you enjoyed it. It was certainly fun getting to hear from you, getting to answer all your questions, and I hope you learned something. And like I said in the beginning, or at some point in this episode, listen through osmosis. Listen to us while you sleep. Eat and drive. Tell a friend. Because without you, the show would be pointless. And if you want to host an event or house an event, you can let us know. And by doing, and ways to do that, you could email us at themeatblockpodcast@gmail.com. Tweet us at themeatblockpod. You get Instagram at themeatblock. If you want to get a hold of me, I'm at American Butcher on Instagram and Facebook. David is at A Farm Butcher, and Ryan is at Gather and Break. If you want to support the show, the best way to do that is by opening up your Apple Podcast listening device, typing in the Meat Block, and leaving a 5-star review. And please, please leave a comment. Another way to support us is by telling a friend or someone who's in the culinary industry, chef, butcher, meat cutter, cousin, daughter, whoever, about this show. Another way to support us is by using the hashtag #TheMeatBlock and tagging us on all previously mentioned social media platforms. Until next time, keep your knife sharp and live in the margin.
That's what I brought to you. I saw you through a broken window with a different point of view. You had signs of depression from a long line of sin. Your face tells a story about the places you have been. I love you so. And that muddy water's flowing, and as you take my hand past the creek down by the hollow, through your daddy's land, and I could buy you a diamond, but I cannot change the world, cause I ain't got no money. You'll never be my
people often ask me why I choose or how I choose the music to go at the end of the show. This was a Chris Knight song, North Dakota. And it's just songs I like. You know, I'll be listening to a certain station on Pandora or Spotify right now. It's a lot of Willie Ray Hubbard. It used to be Hank Williams III, kind of transitioned out of listening to his stations. I grew up listening to, you know, like bands like Alabama, David Allan Coe, 17's Greatest Hits was always in rotation. And even though he's problematic, and I love outlaw country. And when in the very beginning of the show, when it was just David and myself, and David and I used to actually work together, we would enjoy listening to Merle Haggard. And not that like new country's bad. I play a lot of newer country or new, straight up new country. It's just not pop country. And there's tons of songs that I would want to play, but in the beginning when it was just David and myself, I just thought it would be weird if I played a bunch of love songs as outros. Because I do love a bunch of old classic country love songs like Marty Robbins, Jim Reed, and Hank Williams. And I could relate with the downtrodden, you know, someone who's experienced, and I think everyone's experienced some kind of struggle or pain in their life. And I think outlaw country relates to that or can be relatable to that. So awesome. If you stuck around to this part of the episode, if you did, let me know. And until next time, I said it earlier.